Hello friends, we have Vibhor Aggarwal with us. He has secured rank 71 in CSE 2018. We'll start with Vibhor's introduction.
Hello everyone, my name is Vibhor Aggarwal. I secured rank 71 in Civil Services Examination 2018. This was my second attempt and I cleared from the option Political Science and International Relations. I've done my graduation in Electronics Engineering from IIT Kharagpur. I graduated in 2014 and did job in IT sector for 2 years. After that, I decided to leave my job and prepare for civil services and give it my all. And finally, the efforts have been paid.
Were you a very bright student in school, 11th and 12th?
Yes, I was.
Did you score in 10th and 12th?
I scored 93.17 in 10th and 90.25 in 12th. So I was always considered a studious student.
As a studious student. Okay. You did your 11th and 12th in AMU?
Yes.
How was the experience?
It was good. The teaching was very good. Although in AMU, extracurriculars did not happen. And actually, it worked out to my advantage only because I could clear my JEE examination in my first attempt itself.
So you gave 2 prelims and the first time you scored 115 and 111.
Second time 111. Yes.
And this is a comfortable score.
Yes, I've always cleared both the prelims comfortably. So that was a process which I understood my first attempt. The process of revisions, the process of test series. So after that, I became fairly confident that prelims is something which can be cleared if you follow that process.
Can you tell us some of your strategies for prelims?
My first strategy would be to keep your resources minimal. So the minimal your resources and the resources which are covering the maximum portion. For example, Lakshmikant. Lakshmikant has maximum portion. If you take 10 questions of prelims examination, 8-9 can be easily done with Lakshmikant if you have studied it well. So the key is to make the resources minimal, don't go after so many books, but revise them multiple times so that it is ingrained in your brain.
How many times would you have revised Lakshmikant?
Lakshmikant, I would have revised in 3 years, I would have revised it 8-9 times. But I think it is different for every person. So you may have to revise it 25 times. So it depends on how you study. So my studying style was very slow, so I could grasp it better, but I used to read very slowly. So my number of revisions were lesser. But the number of revisions may go up to 25-30 for people who read very fast.
So did you make notes from Lakshmikant or other books?
No, for prelims I did not make any notes because I felt that the books itself were in form of notes and it would be very time consuming to make another notes out of them. So I would use to highlight, I would use to color code them. But apart from that, in prelims I would read from only books.
Role of current affairs in prelims?
It's as important as static. So you have, because current affairs have lesser material to cover, it will take lesser time, but the importance has to be given equally as static because you can never know UPSC. It is the most unpredictable exam and it can give most of the questions as current affairs. It can give most of the questions from static. So the key is to make a fine balance between both.
So what was your source for current affairs?
I used to read Vision IAS current affairs, and I used to read the monthly ones because I felt that in monthly ones, you can keep revising after every month. But PT 365 only comes at the end. So the chances of multiple revisions are lesser there. So I used to read from monthly.
Test series for prelims?
Test series, I did 2 test series. I did from Vision and I did from Forum. I found both of them good.
How many tests did you solve before prelims?
This attempt, 2018, I did between 15 to 20 full tests. 15 to 20 full tests I did.
So do you revise these tests or you just do test one and close it?
What I used to do was, I used to note down the questions, or if there is any specific one-line information, I would note it down separately, or I would note down the question number from each test. And I would revise only those questions. I would not revise the entire test, but I would only revise those particular questions. So it used to save time and it used to work well in that case.
Any specific strategy for art and culture in science and tech?
Art and culture, I felt that there are multiple books I read from Nitin Singhania. So I felt that it covers very wide portion because in art and culture, if you start covering everything, then you would have to read multiple resources. So I found Nitin Singhania good. I think there is Lucent also. So many people recommend it, but I had read Nitin Singhania and I found it very good for art and culture along with the fine arts NCERT of 11th class. So that I felt was...
Science and tech,
I feel 9th and 10th NCERTs can be done. So if you have time, and I think you should take out some time when it comes to science and tech. Read 9th and 10th class NCRTs. Apart from that, there is current affairs.
Current affairs. And how many questions do you usually attempt in a prelims or test?
I used to attempt 90 plus questions, but there is a process which you can take up. So when you are solving, mock test, try to find out your sweet spot. So try to find out you are getting maximum marks in what range.
Range.
So I used to attempt 80 to 85 questions. And when I started attempting 90 plus questions, my marks increased. So what I would do, I would first attempt 75 questions and I would leave all the other questions. Then I would calculate my marks if I would have done 5 or 10 questions more. So I arrived at that if I solve around 90 questions, then I was getting the maximum marks. So I tried that in 3-4 tests and that is what I used to
follow. That is what you have done for prelims also. So coming to prelim mains 2018, how was your approach different from 2017? You did not clear the cutoff for mains 2017.
Yes.
So you changed your approach in 18.
I studied lesser in 2017. The problem was slight underconfidence. So if I have to say what changes I did from first attempt to next attempt, I would say that I calmed myself and I became more confident in what I was doing. So because of underconfidence, I studied lesser. So I wrote lesser answers, I did lesser revisions, and moreover, my preparation level was not up to the mark. So that I corrected in my next attempt.
You've scored a pretty good score for essay this year, 141. What was your approach in essay?
I found a very good article. So that was written by Chandramohan Garg sir. He's of 2016 IAS batch. So he has written a good article on insights on India. So that really opened my mind as to how essays can be written. So that was in my first attempt when I learned how to write an essay.
So in what was the score on essay that year?
It was 132. But there were some mistakes which I corrected in my next attempt. But my base was formed by his article. Because I found that essay is not something which is very subjective. If you objectively analyze essay, if you break it into parts, and if you maintain a flow in objective flow in the essay, then it can be aced very well. So the base was formed in my first attempt itself. In next attempt, I joined MGP Plus program in Forum. So there was a power booklet for essay. That really helped me a lot in understanding what mistakes general mistakes of presentation I was doing. So connectivity between paragraphs, how to start an essay, what will be a better conclusion. So all these things, I learned a lot from that booklet and from the classes that Ayush took. So I think the increase in score and a significant increase in score was because of that.
How many essays did you write before the actual mains?
I wrote around 4-5 essays.
4-5
full essays, I mean the
full
first
papers.
And second, yes.
Did you practice philosophical essays in advance?
Yes, that is a very good improvement that happened in my second attempt. So the ForumIAS test series was designed in a way that you have to attempt one philosophical essay. Otherwise, I felt that I would not be able to write a philosophical essay at all. So because I had to write one, I found that I was able to write it pretty well. And I started preparing more on these essays because I felt that this is something which can be my stronger point. So I started preparing some 7-8 lines poems. So according to the topic, I would make some rhyming words.
So
and
you
I would
created poems for different themes?
No, I would create it on the spot. So whatever the theme will be, based on that, I would write a very simple poem, a first, second class level poem. So it would be of 7-8 lines. I used to do it in philosophical essays. So I would make it on the spot. It used to take 5-10 minutes, but I felt that it would give a very good start.
Okay. For GS 1, 2, 3, 4, strategies?
I think when it comes to general studies, apart from the specific months before prelims or mains, you should do an integrated study. So what I felt was that the knowledge of prelims is very helpful in mains also, and the knowledge of mains, the analytical portion, is very important in prelims examination also. So in prelims, UPSC does not only ask factual questions, it also asks conceptual questions, questions which you would not be able to do if you have not grasp the topic, if you have not grasped the
concept.
Yes. So I felt that an integrated approach should be taken. So there is a lot of overlapping syllabus of polity. In GS1, there is a lot of syllabus, history, apart from world history, geography. So when a person is studying for those subjects, we should do a holistic study. For example, when we are leading Lakshmikant, we should not only focus on remembering the specific points, but we should also focus on the analytical part. If you are reading the Rajya Sabha chapter, so find out more about what problems are occurring in Rajya Sabha, how its efficiency can be improved, etc. Similarly in Parliament also. So that will help you in creating an integrated approach for both prelims and mains.
Paper 1, world history, how much did you study? It has not been a very rewarding topic.
Yes. But I think it's a very tricky topic when it comes
risky.
To... Yes. It's definitely interesting. I found it very interesting. It becomes tricky because this time no question was asked on world history. Last year, one question was
bouncer.
Asked. 10 marker. That was also bouncer. But the...
Last year also bouncer.
Yes, exactly. In 2015, I think there were decent questions. But... you have to study the entire material. So that is a dilemma that you have to face and you have to study, because if UPSC starts asking 3-4 questions suddenly, then you will
How much time did you allocate for world history?
This attempt, I allocated 4 days, 4 half days. I used to study for optional, half day I used to study for general studies. So 4 half days I allocated for
world history
in the first iteration. In the next iterations, it was reduced.
Answer writing approach in paper 1, anything specific, any innovation?
Paper 1, I have got lesser marks in both my attempts, but still I felt the template, the type of paper which has been coming.
You've scored 97.
This time I scored 95.
95.
Last year I scored 98.
The highest score this year is 110.
Okay.
So it's not as low as you think
it's not as low, but still I felt that the question is becoming very holistic. So it will be very difficult. It is very difficult to separate culture question from society or geography question from society. So in paper 1, try to have a multidimensional perspective. That is true for every paper, but in paper 1 it is becoming more and more important. So when a question comes, do not just think that it may be a question of culture. Also try to think from the perspective of society. Also try to think from the perspective of the economic geography. So what impacts can be done? Or
dimensions, actually.
Yeah, multiple dimensions, I think it will help a lot. And certainly diagrams.
Geography.
In culture also, there is a lot of scope of diagrams.
You've used a lot of diagrams and schematics in your answers.
Yes. So, I used to do a lot of maps. Even from paper one. Paper two, there were lesser diagrams because I found the scope a little less. I used to draw flow charts in paper two, but not maps. But in paper one, paper three, I drew a lot of maps. For example, there was a culture question in paper one. So the question was, I think, about Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. Mm. But I drew a map and that I marked different bhakti scents and their locations. So it gives a little
innovation
and a little presentation touch. And if you see some study materials also, in that also some similar type of schematics, etc. are given. So if you can replicate them, so that will be very good.
You scored pretty well in paper 2, 112.
Paper 3.
Paper 2?
GS 2, I have scored 104.
104. The highest is 121.
I think so.
So what was your strategy for paper 2?
Paper 2, a lot of my work became easier because of my optional, the polity and IR part. So I did only for optional, I did not study separately, but I think they also can be done pretty well, they also can be prepared pretty well. I think in paper 2, static material is also very important when it comes
to I've noticed in your answers, you always start with constitutional articles.
Articles, even in governance part, there's a lot of static things, the citizen-centric governance, etc. So these are very static topics for which you need to have information about the things that have been going on in the past also. So those topics actually become the static ones. So even in IR, so IR is a very dynamic portion, but still you need to know some static things about. For example, between India and Iran. So what relations have been going on for a very long time, not just the relations which are now. So I think in paper 2, some static books are very necessary, which may be ignored by many aspirants. So that is something which
maps
can
in
make
IR?
Yes, in IR also maps. For example, India-Israel relations came. So I drew a little map of Asia along with West Asia. So you highlight Israel and you show a connectivity. So that just improves the presentation. It's not a content addition, but just a presentation.
Social justice and IR part, what were your sources?
IR part was again
political science.
So I did not study anything separately. But IR, you can take up some basic book. Any basic book will do. So that will broaden your horizons. So, Pax Indica, or there is a book by Mr. Rajiv Sikri. So, you can do that. Those are outdated books, but they will make your basic concepts very strong.
But it's more current affairs centric.
It's more current affairs centric. But I feel that if you read one static book also, then it will bring a lot of conceptual clarity in a year. In society, there are two society NCRTs. I read only one of them. But apart from that, I think if you have very general understanding about current affairs, about issues, so what you can do in society is you take up the topics. There is a topic of religion, caste, etc., and try to analyze the current trends that are going on. So I think if you are very well versed with the current affairs, society part can be tackled.
Paper three. That's your highest.
That is my highest. That was my strongest paper also because I studied a lot. I put a lot of efforts. So paper three, the syllabus becomes very important, specifically the syllabus, because in economics there is a very wide syllabus and there are very specific terms like MSP, there is marketing, there is animal husbandry,
supply chain
management.
So these are asked this year.
Exactly. And UPSC has a habit of formulating a question entirely out of the syllabus term. So if you have some notes prepared out of those specific syllabus topics, current affairs are in any case very necessary for GS3, but for specific topics, if you have some static 1-2 page some write-up, or you have some material, for example, I refer to VisionIAS material, VisionIAS static material that is there, or Murnal. Murnal has a lot of very good stuff on the static topics of economics. So if you can prepare some 1-2 pages write-up on every static topic for GS3 portion, that will also boost up your marks for a great deal.
What is your answer writing approach in paper 3? Any, how is it different from your paper 1 and paper 2?
Not much different. One very important thing that I learned during MGP in forum was that you should start your answer with something objective.
Something factual. Value addition.
So in GS3 also. So GS3, there's a lot of scope of writing definitions. So what, for example, if they're asking about supply chain management, then what actually supply chain management? If you can draw a schematic showing what actually happens in supply chain management, so the flow. So it will introduce your answer in a very well presented manner. And apart from that, in all four papers, you have to have your own opinions, a constructive opinion. So for example, if there is some issue, you have written pros and cons. But what do you think?
You have to take a stand.
So some issues, there is a scope of writing way forward. Some issues, there is a specific stand. So I think if you can, stand is very important. It will also help you in interview also. But you should make a stand and you should write it in a conclusion, because that is ultimately what the examiner is looking at the end. And that is what can make a lot of difference in your marks from any other candidate who has written a similar answer. So conclusion is very important. Apart from that, the approach was very similar to GS paper 1 or 2.
What was your answer for the Bose-Einstein question? Were you able to write it?
I wrote one page on it. I was not very sure on it.
But so, being an IIT Kharagpur student, you would have known something about it.
I wrote something about it. I had a little idea that it is a fourth or fifth state of matter. So based on that, I drew a little schematic. I wrote some factual information. And I completed in one page because I felt that moving on to second page will show the examiner that you are trying to manipulate
bluff.
Something. That will show.
What do you usually do for such questions where you do not have much content?
I usually used to limit my answer. So most of the answers you will find some content because you can relate it to some other topics. And addressing the need of the question, you can write some related things. But in a question in which you have completely no idea, I think it's better to write whatever you know in a very limited space. So that was a tip which was given to me by Ayush sir. So he told that if you limit it in a given space, the examiner will understand that the person has tried, the person has put efforts in writing some answer, and at the same time, the person is not trying to bluff. That person has written whatever he or she knows. So I think that is the best.
Do you start with the 15 markers or the 10 markers?
I started with the 15 markers.
So you finish the 15 markers and then go to the 10 markers?
Yes.
Because anything different for the first three 10 markers?
I first did 15 markers because I found it a little difficult to shuffle between questions. But in the specific first three 10 markers, those will be the questions which the examiner sees first and will make an impression upon. So you can give a little more time. And even at the end, 8th, 9th or 10th questions, if you have written a little hastily, so that will also not do a lot of damage if you have written the first few questions very well, because the examiner will make an impression out of the first 3-4 questions.
Ethics, strategies, sources, approach?
Ethics, my source was lexicon. Apart from that, I read another very good article by DK Balaji sir. So he cleared in the 2014 examination, and he has written his article on Insights on India itself. So he has explained his approach. He got the highest marks in his attempt. And he has explained that it is not about ethical knowledge, but it is about ethical competence. So how much you are able to show that you are an ethical person rather than throwing away your knowledge that this is the terminology, this is a very
keywords.
Keywords may be necessary, but instead of just throwing apart from knowledge, they are more trying to check whether you're an ethical person or not. So what I think maybe a very good approach is take the keywords from the syllabus itself, as well as various keywords that are written, for example, leadership, there is integrity, etc. Take those keywords, read from any one source. You can Google them, or you can read from lexicon, you can read from any other book, and make a basic understanding of your own. Make a basic understanding of what you understand by integrity, what you understand by leadership. So when you do that, you will be able to show the examiner that you actually have tried and understood those concepts rather than memorize them from some particular book. And moreover, something extra what you can do is, and what I tried in this attempt was, you can prepare specific examples on every particular keyword. For example, leadership. So you can prepare an example of a civil servant who has shown a lot of leadership, or a political leader who has shown a lot of leadership. Similarly, integrity. So examples of T.N. Sheshan sir, etc. Those can be quoted liberally.
Approach in case studies.
Case study, the best approach I think is practice. So my initial practice was done from Gaurav Agarwal sir's answers. So his copies are available online, and I felt that his case studies were one of the best. Even the model answers that are given in test series, I think his answers were better than that. So what I did was, I took a question from his answers. I used to write an answer of my own, and I would compare it with his answers. So when I did for some 10 to 15 case studies, I started understanding what should be the approach, how you should tackle a case study, and that really helped me a lot. And apart from that, as much practice as you can do through test series, through separate case study writings, you should do.
How did you use MGP? What advice would you give for people who will join MGP? How to use it best?
I think you can use it best by sticking to the time schedule, first of all. There may be slight 1 or 2 days variation, but the best thing will be to stick to the timetable, because that will ensure that you do proper revisions and you have time for re-evaluating your mistakes. If you keep the test for the end, many people do that. Many people solve all the tests in the last 1 or 1.5 months, and then you have very lesser time.
You can't expect overnight magic.
Yes. So then you have very lesser time to improve your mistakes. And moreover, you have very less time to revise also, because then you will find out that this was the source I was reading, it was not enough, or this was the source I was reading and it was not a good source. So give those tests on time and also within time. So if this is a 3-hour test, give it within 3 hours.
You did write some tests about time. I was noticing one test you had taken 1 hour extra.
I took 1 hour extra. In that test, I was experimenting a little. I was experimenting with my presentation things. So I decided that let me give a lot of time in that test.
On one particular test?
On one particular test I did.
For a specific purpose?
For a specific purpose, because I had to show it to you. I had to show that these are the things I'm trying. If this is the presentation which you feel will be a good one.
Will this be better or the other?
So I used to take around 10-15 minutes extra in initial tests. So I think that also should not be done. So
eventually in the UPSC exam, you were able to complete all the
papers? I was able to complete in my last two tests. In my last two tests, I completed on time. But I think it's better if you start from that first test itself.
Maintain that continuity.
If there is some specific experiment which you are trying, you can do that. But one very good experiment should also be to give it on time. Because if you are not able to do it on time here, it will be very difficult to manage your time in the examination.
Optional, you have scored 297.
297.
What was your strategy for political science? You improved from 210 to 211 to 297.
Yes.
That is a big jump.
So in optional, I was facing a frog in the well syndrome in my first attempt. So I was at my home. So I did not bother checking what type of answers other people were writing. I did not bother checking what type of strategy other people were employing. So I just read my notes, whatever the Shubhranjan ma'am gave. I read those notes. I gave few tests and that was it. But it was not sufficient because the number of revisions were not enough. I had done last revision 5-6 days before the actual examination. And later I came to know that people were revising the entire syllabus one day before the actual examination. So that makes a lot of difference. So this time I consulted a lot of...
This time you had more time between the exams also for optional.
This time I think it was lesser than last
time. Okay.
A little lesser than last time. But at the same time I consulted with a lot of people, people who had got good marks. And I found that there was one key thing that everyone was doing, that was making crisp notes out of whatever material you are studying. So the basic material is always ma'am's notes for everyone. But apart from that, any book you are reading, people used to make consolidated crisp notes, which you can revise one day before the examination. So I felt that the key is to remember the keywords, the name of books, the name of scholars very well and put it on the paper. So that was one thing.
So did you go beyond ma'am's notes and research further and add things or?
For few things. For example, for paper 2, I did that. For paper 1, section 1, I completely read on ma'am's notes. For paper 1, section 2, it's polity. So there are current affairs which you have to read. So I did that. But in paper 2, section 1, I read Andrew Haywood Global Politics. So I found that a very good book and I found that as a very good value addition upon ma'am's notes. So that I read, and in paper 2, section 2, I read extra articles, for example, C. Raja Mohan sir's articles from Indian Express, etc. But one very important source is Rajya Sabha TV videos. That is India.
Paper 2, section 2.
Paper 2, section 2, India's world. So it may be, if you are watching every day the big picture, then it's a good thing. If you're not, then at least you can take out time every week to see India's world. And if you do that, I did that after my mains examination when I was preparing for interview. I had not seen regularly. I had not seen India's world regularly before that. And when I was getting up after writing my paper 2 section 2, when the examination was over, I realized that a very big mistake that I have done is not watching those videos.
Maybe you could have added another 10 marks.
I really think that if I would have done that, I could have added 20 to 30 marks more. I have got 140 marks.
Into the top 20 rank.
Top 20, 30 ranks I could have, because as soon as I got up, I realized that this should have been done, because what they are trying to check is not some rote learning which you have done. The questions were very conceptual. The questions demanded clear understanding of the relations of India with other countries. And you can only gain that understanding when you have analyzed their relations from a very scholarly perspective, which you can really get from India's world. So what you can do is, what any aspirant can do is, they can take up past 1 year videos. If they are preparing for India-Pakistan, then they can see all the videos of India-Pakistan of past 1 year together. So that will really boost up your conceptual understanding of what actually is going between both countries.
Okay. Coming to interview preparation, what is your strategy this year?
My strategy was to first of all create a document. So application form is the bare minimum and I think the only consolidated source which you can prepare on. Otherwise, they can ask on any topic. So I think that is the only preparation apart from
the current DAF, affairs. Extensive the DAF, preparation on the DAF.
Extensive preparation. So write every keyword which you feel. Even my address was silver. There was a word silver. And in one of the mock interviews, they asked me the atomic number and mass of silver. And that can be done in the actual interview as well if they want to do it. So write every keyword, prepare basic information on it. You should be well aware on whatever keywords are written. Prepare on that. Apart from that, current affairs are very necessary. You should be doing that for the mains as well, preparing an opinion on every issue, because you have to write that on conclusion, and whatever you're writing in conclusion, you have to give that as an answer in interview. So you have a very clear and very logical opinion on every issue that has been going on, because that will be expected of you. And if you're not able to give a logical explanation of that, then it will give a very bad impression.
How many mocks did you give?
I gave around 6 mocks.
6 mocks. How was the mocks different from the actual interview?
The unpredictability. Because in mocks, there was a certain pattern on which mocks used to go.
So keywords of the question.
Keywords of the question. Because in mocks, the one aim is also to make you prepared. So the questions are asked from the DAF, from current affairs.
As extensively as possible.
As extensively as possible. But in actual interview, it is not the case.
Selected few areas.
They may ask on one topic itself. I have heard that on topics like agriculture, entire interview has gone. So my two panelists asked only from international relations from me. I had actually mentioned it in my interest, But apart from that, from two panelists, the entire...
Any interesting question in your interview?
No, not specifically. There were nothing much. So there were just some current affairs questions, questions from my hometown, etc. There were questions, unpredictable questions. For example, they were asking me TQM. The chairman asked me TQM, total quality management. So that I came to know later. And he was asking me about brand management. So these are all...
Was it connected to your app?
No, in no way. So I was also a little confused, but the important point is that you have to remain calm. Whatever you know, you tell them. Whatever you don't know, you tell.
So you ended up not answering a few questions.
I told them straight away. So he asked me, what is TQM? I said, I don't know. He said that it is total quality management. And he was a little surprised. He said, you don't know. And I said, I'm really sorry, sir. I don't know about it.
But you maintained your calm.
You have to maintain your calm. Otherwise, it may be the only thing that he was checking by asking TQM. So you never know. So keeping your calm, remaining confident, and remaining honest is very important.
What is the most interesting experience you had after the result came, after you secured the rank?
I think most interesting experience was when a neighborhood auntie came to me, and her son was studying in 9th class. And she came to me and she started saying, ki, give him tips of civil services. So I was very surprised, because at that age, you should let people roam around, you should let people play, and the basic study of 9th class is all that is required. So the only response that I could give was I could laugh.
You could ask him to study NCERT of 9th standard properly.
I only said him that enjoy your time right now, okay? Just keep a habit of reading newspapers. Apart from that, enjoy right now.
Because what advice would you give your first attempt self?
I would give that remain confident. This is an exam which can be cleared in the first attempt. There are a lot of examples, specifically in 2018 examination. Top 5 people, there are 3 people who are first attempters. So remain confident. Remain confident that if you work on your mistakes, if you have faith that given the efforts, you will clear this exam, then everything will fall into place. And if you are not able to gather that confidence, then this exam may be one of the toughest examinations that you may face. So have faith in yourself, keep calm, and keep working on your mistakes.
Any final tip for the aspirants?
I'll say that prepare for exam. Increase your knowledge. Read books, read current affairs. But at the same time, prepare for the final day itself. Because nothing can make you clear the exam if you're not able to perform on the final day. So that includes practicing a lot. That includes giving mock tests for prelims, for mains, for interviews. And that also includes maintaining your health. Sleep on time, do yoga, do exercises, do meditation, whatever will help you maintain a good physical and mental physique. Because the most important thing is for you to perform on that day, not the number of books or the amount of material you are reading. So keep yourself in the utmost fit position for you to give your utmost and the best performance on that day itself.
Thank you, Vibhor. Thank you so much. Thank you.